pleasure to welcome back Dr. Paul Craig Roberts to the show, former Assistant Secretary of the Treasury of Economic Policy during the Reagan administration and a columnist for the Wall Street Journal, Business Week. Welcome back, Dr. Roberts.
Hello, Chris.
Your website is filled with topicality. At least one that caught my attention was another phony jobs report that you penned recently. You also follow another guest of the show, Mr. John Williams of Shadow Stats. An interesting metric that I don't think the mainstream really picked up on. 200,000 jobs that we gained might be not quite as solid as our officials or our policymakers would have us think. You say that this might just be an assumption made by the birth-death model, you refer to it. More hedonic nonsense, smoke and mirrors.
Yes. Back during the Reagan years, the first term of Reagan, when the everybody was ganging up on Reagan and on supply-side economics. And so when the policies finally got partially implemented, you know, they were delayed a couple of years before they went into effect, the economy quickly recovered, and there was a big increase in jobs. Only the Bureau of Labor Statistics missed it and said, oh, there's no jobs, no, it's not working. Because they missed the increase in jobs and were subsequently embarrassed by this, they invented what they call the birth-death model. By birth and death, they're talking about the creation of new businesses that have not yet reported the payroll employment to BLS, businesses that have failed and gone out of business and have not reported the job losses. And their model assumes a rising economy, not a flat or declining economy. And in the rising economy, they made an assumption that there were so many new jobs created every month, because the creation of new jobs that were unreported exceeded the failed companies whose job loss was not reported. And so this sort of model doesn't work in the type of economy we've had in the 21st century. And so all the jobs they're reporting are really a product of this add-on factor in that model. And the rest of the jobs are a product of the games they play with seasonal adjustments. And John Williams is the one who has most explained this. And so when you see that we've had 250,000 jobs, most likely you haven't had any. And another reason that we can take confidence that we're not having these jobs is that the participation rate of the workforce has been falling year after year. And so that tells you that there are not employment opportunities, because historically, if the economy is growing and there are jobs available, the participation in the workforce rises. It doesn't shrink. And yet the participation rate has consistently fallen and is really at a extreme low. So these jobs are not real. And as I have reported, Chris, if you look at the location of these jobs, according to the BLS, they're all domestic service, lowly paid, part-time domestic service jobs, waitresses, bartenders, retail clerks, hospital orderlies. It's that type of thing. So, and this has been consistent for years. If you look at where they say the jobs are, you know, it's always waiters and bartenders and retail clerks. And this is the labor force of a third world country. This is not the labor force of an industrialized, manufacturing, first world economy. So what we see, even if these jobs were actually there, and it's a puzzle, why so many waiters and bartenders when discretionary income of people is not rising? And why so many new retail clerks when... So it really looks like the jobs are made up. But even if they aren't, it's not assuring. It's very disturbing because it says that the economy can no longer create the kinds of jobs that pay enough that people can establish independent households. And, of course, another indication that these jobs are not there, or if they are, aren't any good, is the fact that, according to all the data, more than half of American 25-year-olds live at home with their parents. They can't get employment sufficient to move in with a girlfriend or have a roommate or even share rent on an independent existence. And then it turns out that more people aged 24 to 34 live at home with parents than they live independently. So you can see then that there's a collapse of income opportunity in the economy, and that the younger people joining the workforce simply don't have good prospects. So that, I think, sums up the true picture. There's simply not been a recovery. And what caused the destruction of job opportunity in the United States was the offshoring of American jobs. First, the offshoring of the manufacturing jobs, and then the offshoring of the tradable professional skill jobs, such as software engineering, research, design, that type of thing. Even architects, and now a lot of accounting work. As these jobs moved offshore, discretionary spending power of Americans declined, and the growth of American consumer income ceased. So there was nothing to drive the economy. And that's when Alan Greenspan launched the first of the Fed's big bubbles. He said, well, there's no income growth to drive the economy, and so what the Fed will do is supply an increase in consumer indebtedness in place of the missing growth in income. And by increasing their debt, consumers can spend more. And the easiest way to do that is to lower the interest rates, because that drives up housing prices. And then people can refinance their house with a higher mortgage. But since the interest rates are low, the payment doesn't grow, and they can take out the equity and spend it, and that will keep the economy going. So that was the Greenspan solution. And, of course, that works until people can't take on any more debt. It works until the real estate prices are a bubble. They're bid out of all proportion. And it works until all the financial institutions realize that in that type of atmosphere, they can commit massive fraud. And that's what the securitization of mortgages permitted them to do, because the people who made the loans no longer held the mortgages. So it didn't matter to them if the mortgages were sound or not, because they collected a fee for issuing a mortgage, and then they sold the mortgage, and then the mortgages were packaged and sold to investors. There was no connection between making a loan and the risk of the loan. So all those three things came into effect and bit hard, and we had the downturn. I think John Williams is correct that we have never come out of the downturn, and in fact, we may possibly be beginning to have a further downturn. So that is my summation of the situation.
I think it's an excellent summation, and I'm sure you've seen the numbers on Shadow Stats that if you adjust the GDP by a more appropriate inflation figure, deflator, if you will, we never emerged from the early 2000 recession. You could make the argument, at least according to his data there, that the GDP has remained in either close to negative territory or in negative territory for approximately 15 consecutive years. And it really corroborates, and I think underscores, the argument you've made here today. And I guess it shouldn't really be a surprise when 500,000 solid industrial-based jobs, manufacturing jobs, if you will, with perquisites, have just evaporated, been shipped offshore. But our listener base, they're familiar with that. They're very savvy. They might be wondering, is there a panacea that comes to mind?
Well, I don't know what panacea it would be. Essentially, what happened was when the Soviet Union collapsed, China and India, China was allegedly communist and India was socialist, and they did not have a positive attitude toward foreign capital coming into their country. So their large underutilized labor forces were not available to first world companies to move their production offshore where labor was cheaper and then pocket the difference as profits and managerial bonuses and capital gains for shareholders. So that option didn't exist until the Soviet Union collapsed and China and India adopted different policies. They came to the conclusion that they had to do more like the West because their system really didn't work. Look what happened to the Soviet Union. So once that started, firms who maybe were not doing so well said, look, we can boost our profits by making this stuff in China and bring it back here to sell. So let's close down all the plants here and get this going. And it, once it got started, Wall Street, or what they're called shareholder advocates, they forced the remaining firms to do the same thing under threat of takeovers. Wall Street simply told the corporations, no matter how big they were, you know, multi-billion-dollar corporations, move offshore or we'll finance a takeover of the company because we want the higher profits that will come from the substantial drop in labor costs. What we have done is simply deindustrialize, the opposite of economic development. I don't know. One day I want to sit down and think up a term for the opposite of economic development. It's disdevelopment. So when you do that, look what you do. First of all, you deprive states and localities and federal government of tax base because all income, personal income, and as all the sales tax as well on the spending of consumers and so on, that's gone. So states and counties began having problems, and this meant also problems for their systems. And for some states, it meant problem for their municipal bond ratings. That sets in. And then also you start losing a skilled labor force. I mean, our skills are acquired through time and learned and passed on and relate to the process that's being used in the manufacturing. And so you lose that. And then you lose all the supply chains so that, you know, firms are not, they don't produce all their own inputs. You know, they buy things and they put them together and they make a product. And then you lose your supply chain. So even if you wanted to start making something, where are your suppliers? So it's very hard to recover from this. Moreover, you've given all of your technology to the other countries with the cheap labor. And so if you want to get going again, you've got to have tariffs to keep out their products because in the old days they could not outcompete you because they didn't have your technology. It's cheap labor. But your technology compensated for that, and so you were more productive even though they had cheap labor. But when they've got your technology, that's gone. That advantage is gone. And so you would have to have protected markets. And, of course, the World Trade Organization and so on, and all that prohibits tariffs. So how can you get it back? You know, you possibly could change the way you tax corporations. You could say if a corporation produces the goods and services offshore that it sells to Americans, we'll tax them at a higher rate, we'll tax their profits at a higher rate than if they produce the goods and services they sell to Americans here domestically. So possibly you could use this difference in the tax rate depending on the location where corporations add value to their products. If that happens domestically, a low tax rate. If that happens abroad, a high tax rate. You might be able to fix it that way. But you wouldn't be able to get it passed because the corporations are too powerful. They are one of the global corporations are one of the major interest groups that control the Senate, the House, the President, the regulatory agency. So they would simply say no. So it's not clear that you can recover. I mean, you can think up some scenarios. You could say, well, maybe a whole different kind of technology will come along, and it'll be invented here, that, it'll be so different that none of the existing supply chains and skills are irrelevant, and that we'll just simply start all over on the basis of some new technology, you know, cold water fusion, or I mean, who knows what it could be, some new energy force. So you could say, yeah, that's possible. This would happen, and that when this came along, the leaders would see it was important to keep this here, and would take steps to prevent it being offshored as well. But that's about all I can think of, at least at this time.
I wonder if you could give our precious metals aficionados a ray of hope. You know, I mean, we obviously have seen an unusual situation, probably due at least in part to negative rates on both sides of the U.S. here. I mean, the BOJ and the European Central Bank in negative territory, at least on some of their sovereign debt. That, of course, has led to a stock market rally as funds flow in the United States. You know, bonds continue to do well, which is a little unusual to see them moving in tandem. And then the precious metals have had one of the best rallies in something like almost 30 years. Can you give us an idea of whether or not it would be a sound investment, a prudent decision to continue accumulating the precious metals, not just as a diversification method, perhaps even for, improved expected returns and lower volatility?
First of all, let me say that I don't think any of the markets, neither stocks, bonds, real estate, or precious metals, are driven by fundamentals at this time, nor have they been, I think, for most of the 21st century. Certainly for the last 5 years, let's put it that way, or since the crash in December of 2007, during this so-called period of recovery, fundamentals are not important. They have had no effect on anything. If fundamentals were operating with the enormous amount of buildup of debt at all levels, you know, public and private, individual, everybody's, corporate, federal, bond prices would be very low. The interest rates would be high just because the ratio of debt to GDP has risen so sharply that the risk of debt service would provoke higher interest rates. But we don't see that. Now, if we look at the stock market, very high stock market during this period, but it's not based on fundamentals. If you look at the P.E. ratios, they're very high historically. The period in which firms were making profits, it was largely due to the fact they were moving jobs offshore, and the lower labor costs were showing up as profits. And we look at the absence of growth in discretionary consumer income. We can't project profits from the future because there's no income growth of population. So we can't say that these P.E. ratios are profit-based. If we look at gold and silver prices, we would say, you know, they should be very, very high because the Federal Reserve has created so many new dollars that are not matched by growth in goods and services. The notion that the dollar still has the same value is unrealistic, and therefore the gold and silver prices should be reflecting the oversupply of dollars that the Fed created to essentially support the balance sheets of the banks too big to fail. So what is happening? What's driving the stock and bond prices up? And then we'll ask what's more or less had a lid on the gold and silver prices. Well, what's driven the stock and bond prices up is the extraordinary liquidity created by the Fed. It has to go somewhere. The Fed is putting it into bonds. This is, you know, this is what QE was all about. It was to create huge sums of money to support bond prices, which means to drive the interest rates down. So the explanation of the stock market and the bond market is the Fed liquidity. Can they quit? Apparently not. If they quit, then they've got the thing unraveling on them. So if we now look at gold and silver, what happens there? Well, Dave Kranzler and I published a number of articles proving beyond all doubt that the gold and silver prices were consistently driven down by the bullion banks, who are agents of the Federal Reserve, selling naked shorts in the futures market. In other words, they were shorting the market with uncovered shorts. In other words, since the price of gold and silver is determined in the futures market, which is a paper market, the bullion banks can print up an endless supply of paper gold in the form of futures contracts. So the supply of gold in the market where the price is determined was being printed up just like the supply of dollars was being printed up. So the bullion banks print up a bunch of shorts at some quiet time in the market. They dump massive amounts of shorts. This drives down the price. It sets off stop loss orders. It sets off margin calls. The price goes down further. The bullion banks then cover their shorts and pocket the difference. But the gold price has been taken way down dramatically. And they began doing this in earnest in the fall, I think, of 2011, and they've not stopped. Now, the rally that you call it this year, I mean, it's not a rally. It's simply been less naked short selling, or less often. And therefore, the real fundamentals in the market have been able to operate a little more. The real fundamentals is that the demand for gold and silver is high. Supply may be strained, and so the price should be rising. And so what has happened, and I don't know precisely the reason, though I think I have an idea, and I'll mention that. So what has happened is the bullion banks haven't been selling as many naked shorts on the COMEX, you know, in the middle of the night or sometime when there's no active trading or anything. So why haven't they? Well, this is speculation. And I think the answer may be that the West's ability to meet the strong Asian demand, the Chinese and Indian demand for bullion, is diminishing because the stocks of gold and silver in the West have been depleted in making these sales all during this period when the price is kept below the price it would be in a market that didn't have naked short selling. And so, by holding down the price, there's been a greater quantity of gold and silver demanded, and the supplies in the West are not what they were, and therefore it gets harder to use naked shorts to keep the price of bullion down. That's my take on it. I wouldn't bet my life on it, but that's the best answer I have to it.
What would be the implications, do you think, for the typical Westerner or American when the more realistic price for the yellow metal is reestablished and currencies are also adjusted to reflect their intrinsic value?
Well, the Fed rules the other central banks, and so if the Fed had to create trillions of new dollars, they have to protect the dollar's value, not just against gold, by having the market shorted, but against other currencies. And so they do the way they do that, they go to Japan, which has one of the other large currencies. They go to the euro, the European Central Bank, which has another of the large currencies, and they say, you two both have to do quantitative easing. And both central banks have been doing that now for some time. I think the Japanese rate of quantitative easing was even greater than the Fed's. And, of course, the European Central Bank has been doing quantitative easing and not long ago announced they were increasing the amount. And we have even the Bank of England doing quantitative easing. So you have the alternative currencies to the dollar, the yen, the euro, the pound, all printing madly as well. So if all the currencies are being printed, it's not possible for one to drop relative to the others, not in any meaningful sense. In other words, since the Japanese and Europeans and the British are printing money, they can't say, oh my gosh, look at all the money the Americans have printed. Currency traders can't say, well, you know, that much increase in supply, these other currencies aren't. There goes the dollar's exchange value. That doesn't happen if all the banks are printing. And once you start printing, it forces everybody. You may remember a few years ago, people trying to escape the dollar because of the money printing were flocking into the Swiss franc. It drove the Swiss franc up so high that the Swiss government announced that any further capital inflows into the country would be met with an increase in the supply of Swiss francs. In other words, they would simply print the money to stop the Swiss exchange rate from rising because they weren't able to sell anything. The currency was driven up so high. So everybody prints. So if everybody is printing, there's no reason for one currency to decline relative to the other, or no reason for one currency to rise relative to the other. So that situation is stable. And since most of the money printing has gone into asset inflation, stock and bond prices, certain kinds of real estate, and not into the economy, the governments have not had to worry about hyperinflation. Of course, our inflation is higher than they admit, but it's not unlivable yet. So as long as this money creation goes into financial assets, it can continue. And that's why people are still in the stock market, because the Fed is driving it up by printing money. Now, at some point, you say, how can it go into bonds when there's a zero interest rate? I mean, nobody wants to buy a bond and get back less than he bought. And this has happened with Treasury bills and a few other instruments, but it appears to be because the purchasers don't trust the banks. And so they'll pay a premium to be in Treasury bills. But there's a limit to that. If the interest rates can't get too negative, if the liquidity that's been going into bonds, really can't go there anymore. Where does it go? Well, probably stocks. So we could have even more unrealistic P.E. ratios. It would be going into gold and silver, except we have the bullion banks able to sell naked shorts in vast quantities and drive down the price. So if something happens that means the West can't meet Asian demand for gold, so they can't drive down the gold price with naked shorts, the liquidity can go into gold and up can go the gold price. In fact, it could be the liquidity driving up the gold price much more than the fear of investors of the dollar. So these things we just don't know. My own view, and this comes from not having expected this house of cards to stand this long. It's been a stronger house of cards than anybody would think who looks at it on the basis of fundamentals, but you can't look at it on the basis of fundamentals. You have to look at it as a rigged system maintained by the Fed and the other central banks, in which fundamentals play almost no role. So what could happen? Well, if something were to happen to the dollar, the Fed would have to choose between the banks too big to fail and the dollar. And since the power of the United States government is based on the dollar, the Fed would have to say, save the dollar, let the banks go. And to save the dollar, they would have to be able to attract foreign investment, foreign currencies, foreigners who want to be in dollar-denominated assets. So the interest rates would have to go up. Well, when that happens, a lot of debt relationships are going to unwind, and you're probably going to have an economic depression. Another thing that could set off the dollar, I don't know what would set that off. I mean, but that would be a consequence if something set it off. So what could set it off? Well, if somehow other countries have suffered enough from American financial imperialism, you know, like the French bank that had to pay $9 billion because it did business with some country that the Americans didn't approve of. And why did they have to pay that $9 billion? Because if they didn't, Washington told them, you'll be cut out of the American banking system. That means they can't settle international financial transactions. Well, this type of bullying, and that's just one example. That was the French bank. This type of bullying has happened all over a lot of people. And so there's now, it's more than rumor, I think, a new clearing system is being created. All the banks can clear directly with one another and not have to go through the American clearing mechanism. Well, if this gets up and running, then it means all these big banks no longer have any need for dollar reserves. That would mean the support for the dollar is gone. Now, whereas the Fed can print endless amount of dollars to support bond and stock prices, they can't print foreign currencies to support the dollar. So if there's this departure from the use of dollars and the use of the American clearing system for international transactions, Now we know the BRICS were already starting that, you know, and that the Russians and the Chinese have made various deals, and the other members of the BRICS have agreed to trade in their own currencies and not use a dollar clearing mechanism or not trade in dollars. But if this happens in a big way, for example, Japanese banks, British banks, European banks, the ability of the dollar to maintain its exchange rate is diminished, even if the other currencies are still being printed, because a huge chunk of demand for dollars is taken out, and therefore the only way you could maintain the dollar's exchange rate would be if the other currencies started printing even more in order to compensate for the drop in demand for dollars because people cease using American clearing system, which of course means they don't need dollar balances. So that is something that could happen. I think once it looks like the dollar is going to lose demand, given the huge supply of them out there, that the gold and silver price would go up very quickly. That's just the way it looks to me, because where would the money go? I don't think it can go into bonds any longer. The P.E. ratios of stocks are high. They all go higher. But at some point, people say, now, wait a minute. We've created trillions of new dollars, and now the demand for dollars has collapsed. Where does the money go? It could go into other currencies. But it could also go into gold and silver.
I wonder then if you would be an advocate of sound money and safe haven assets for the typical investor, given your concern about the retirement issues.
It's hard to advise people when there are no longer any rules. You know, what is sound money? Well, if we say it's gold and silver, well, but it can be confiscated. I mean, remember, they confiscated, FDR confiscated gold before. When I was coming along, we still had silver coins, and there were treasury notes that could be redeemed for silver, and they took that away. So I don't really know what you do when there are no rules. I think you have to do, everybody has to make up their own mind, and certainly gold and silver would have far more intrinsic value than pieces of currency, paper currency. And they've always been the world's money in history. And so if you debauch a currency, a paper currency, then you need some kind of currency and to debauch. So they can be, you know, the Roman silver denarius was so debauched that it became almost solid lead. So you can have inflation even with when you have a bullion currency. So, you know, there really aren't rules. And but I do think that the system is unstable. It's a house of cards. It can come unglued. And I think in the dollar, if the dollar becomes troubled, they won't be able to drive down gold and silver price by shorting futures market. And as I said previously in this conversation, Chris, if they were not shorting gold and silver, which they have been doing consistently since the end of 2011, the gold and silver price would be far higher than they are right now.
And I'd like to encourage all of our listeners to navigate your browsers to the website and, of course, bookmark Paul Craig Roberts, that's all one word, .org, paulcraigroberts.org, especially the articles and columns section. I mean, this is a just important resource. Topicality is outstanding. Dr. Roberts, any parting comments or any other contact information you'd like to leave with the listeners today?
No, that's fine. I appreciate your effort to try to keep people informed. They can't get very good information from the media or Wall Street or academic economists, or all of that is just part of the disinformation that they use to keep the house of cards standing. It's very difficult for people to get good information, and I try to give it to them, and I don't have anything depending on it. My thoughts may not be the best in the world, but they are fairly pure. So good luck to everybody.
Thank you, sir. Your efforts are appreciated here.
All right. Goodbye.
The gold and silver mining sector is red hot. Every investment portfolio needs precious metal shares. GoldSeek.com's top stock analysts have done it again, identifying the next solid gold nugget opportunity, Brazil Resources. Based in the eighth largest economy with a mining-friendly reputation, almost 10 million ounces of gold reserves, industry insiders are accumulating shares of Brazil Resources. The notable management team includes Chairman Amir Adnani, a rising star in the mining industry with a reputation for moving projects rapidly into production. Fortune magazine lists Chairman Adnani in the prestigious list of 40 under 40 ones to watch. Watch. Plus, shareholders benefit from the insights and backing of enigmatic Brazilian billionaire Mario Garneiro, CEO of Brazil Invest Group, the nation's foremost merchant and investment bank, and founding director. Their São Jorge project is 100% owned with paved highway access, a nearby workforce, and a hydroelectric power source near the major gold deposits. Their next top project includes three deposits identified by major gold producers, plus their Ria project, which is a joint venture with Areva, benefits from a $10 million treasure map in the hottest address for uranium production in Canada. But the story gets even more exciting with their Whistler project, offering geographic diversification in South Central Alaska. To find out more about this unique opportunity, please direct your web browsers to BrazilResources.com. At Yahoo Finance, ticker symbol BRI.V. Remember, to ride the exciting gold stock run of 2016 and beyond, your portfolio will thank you for adding shares of Brazil Resources.
GoldSeek employees may or may not own shares. Nothing contained herein should be construed as investment advice.